Well, I'm glad that you're here, and it is a pleasure for me. I hope you don't mind, Cindy, but Cindy is one of my coworkers, and I'm as, and she can vouch for me. I am as ornery at work as I am here, you just ask her. She'll let you know. But it's good to have you with us, Cindy. Welcome to the family. I don't know, you know, these guys are great, and you'll find out, you know, real quick. They just adopt everybody they can. Just wanted to welcome you. Well, guys, you didn't come to see me. I know that. Well, it's nice to see you, too. You came because you wanted to worship God. You wanted to, you know, looking forward to this day and just thinking about all that Jesus has done for you, your salvation, you know, you wanted to say thanks. You wanted to express gratitude. Amen? Right? Yeah. Me too. God is so good, and he's worthy of our worship and praise. I'd like to open with a word of prayer, and then we'll sing we'll sing some songs together. Then we'll have an offering, and then we'll look at God's word. Kind of excited today. We're going to be in the Valley of Dry Bones. Yeah, that should be fun. Father, I come to you in the name of God the Father and God the Son, Jesus Christ, God the Holy Spirit. Lord, it is really true. We came to be with you. We came to worship you. And we tell you honestly, Lord, we are amazed by your grace. Because we do not really feel worthy. We look back and we see ourselves for who we are. And we know without a doubt that we are what we are today. And we've been elevated because of you. You are worthy of all of our worship. Please receive it from us, from the front of this room to the back of this room, to those online. Be honored, be magnified, be glorified, for that's our heart's intention. And all the people of God said, and amen.
Going to sing about God's amazing grace today. They're fast, but not that fast. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. It's amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amen. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Hey, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Woo. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Lord has promised good to me. word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. Amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace. Amen. Hallelujah. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer the sea so I If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. When there's a better life, there's a better life. If you've got pain, he's pain taker. Feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chain, he's a chain breaker. Oh yeah. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh yeah. Somebody justify. Hallelujah.
Father in heaven, we just come to you. We come to you as a congregation. We come to you as children of the King, children of God. We come to you as a child of God. We've just been singing that. We're a child of God. Not because of anything we've done other than to say yes to you, but because of all that you've done for us. And as a people, Lord, and I get to put the words together this morning, but I'm praying for each and every person here and online, their thoughts, their hearts. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for the new life. Thank you for making us a child. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for your favor and your blessings upon our lives. We have so much to be thankful for. You know, Lord, I was just talking a little bit earlier about children and our children. And I think about my life, and I know that I'm speaking for everyone here as we take inventory and stock in our lives. Even with all the bad stuff, we have so much to be thankful for. And you're worthy of our praise and our thanks. Father, this morning we come to you and we lift the congregation to you. We We thank you for Doc being with us today, but we ask your touch to continue to be upon him and those in our congregation, like Cheyenne this morning, we miss her. That you would just have your hand upon them, that you would heal. We got pain, you're the pain taker. We pray, Father, for those in our congregation who need your touch, not just in a physical way, but who need your touch in an emotional way. Sometimes we get down. We just need you, Lord. We need to look up and know that you got us. We sometimes need that extra presence, your presence, that just gives us a peace that passes understanding. And that sense, Lord, to know that we are loved no matter what. We come to you, Lord, and we pray for our congregation who has relationships that are struggling and perhaps not what they need to be. And you've called us as people, as your people, to be ministers of reconciliation. And sometimes we look at things said and wonder how in the world they can be undone, but with your help, Holy Spirit. And so I pray for those in our midst who need to just fix some relationships. I pray, Father, we pray for our congregation, for those who've been wondering how in the world they'll make the next rent and their finances need help. And we remember and we understand that you're the great I am and that you can provide ways where there seems to be no way. And so we lift them to you. Father, we turn our hearts, we turn our minds away from ourselves and towards our neighbor, towards those who live around us and those, Lord, in our workplace and those, Father, in the marketplace that we see each and every week. And we pray for them. And we ask you, Lord Jesus, to teach us as you have instructed us to love our neighbor the way we love ourselves. And we'll do the best we can. And we know your Holy Spirit will do the rest. Father, we pray for our leadership, but the leadership in our church, the leadership in our city, the leadership in our state, in our nation, and the leadership that's in our world, Lord. And some of them would be what we classify as enemies, and you're telling us to love even our enemies. We pray for them, we do. We don't understand and we work through it. We trust, Holy Spirit, you'll lead us through it. And then we want to close, Lord, with our thoughts on you. This morning, prayer of thanks for the incarnation. Jesus, that you would come that Christmas morn. Thank you for that. Thank you for the cross. Thank you, Lord, for the work of the cross and the blood that was shed. Thank you, Lord, for an empty tomb and the promise of eternal life that it holds, that it proves. Thank you for the witness of the multitude who saw you in the ascension. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Holy Spirit to the church. Lord, as you've seen us express it here this morning in our worship, we just want you to know, Jesus, we love you. We love you with our heart. We love you with our being. And all the people of God said, and amen, and amen. Well, because, Jackie, I was busy setting up the streaming, I forgot to make out my check. See me after church, okay? Let's worship the Lord with his tithes and our offerings. Father, as these gentlemen come, we just pray that you would bless the gift and bless the giver in an extra special way. None of us give, Lord, out of a compulsion. None of us are given because we feel we must. We just give because we want to say thank you for all that you've done for us. Receive it as such. It's worship for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Miss Nellie. Thank you for your ministry. Amen. It is it's a joy to stand here before you this morning with a message from the Lord. I would give you a little background to the message and its inspiration. I was listening to the radio this week on the way home, and I've thought about this before. It's about the dry bones and breathe, oh breath of God. How many of you know that? How many of you heard that song on the radio? Yeah. I was thinking about that, and I have never preached about this particular text. This is a first for me, and we'll go through it together. I'll have it up on the screen, and we'll go through it in just a moment. But I was thinking, as I was listening to it, and it's a text often preached for revival, you know, for the church to be revived, and it's often used that way. I know I've heard messages on it. I've just never preached on it. But the truth is, it points to Christ and what He wants to do in our life, and. It's really the life that we seek. And as I was listening to it, I was picturing in my mind what happened in the valley. And this thought occurred to me because I was thinking about you, and I was thinking about me, and I was thinking about the resurrection and what that will be like, and all the doubt that comes with all that, the naysayers might say. And sometimes we wonder and question, you know. But what occurred to me was, if God could do this then, and He has, and it's history, this is an event, not a story, this is an event. And in such a miraculous way, it's no problem for Him to do this at the resurrection, is it? And His promises are true, and He never changes. And I hope you're encouraged when we get done. The title of the message, as I titled them all, The Life You Seek. The key verse that I want to give to you, I'll not repeat this verse again, at least I don't think I will, comes out of Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus, the second chapter, the fourth verse. You see it up there. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which He loves us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with Him. Catch the position we get. And raised up with Him and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Father, as we look at your word and we look at it more in depth, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would move in and out. Holy Spirit, you're the great teacher. Say what I cannot, say what I do not, and just help me as I proclaim or prophesy your word. In Jesus' name, I ask these things. Amen. not a particular term you've heard me use before, but we'll talk about prophets and prophecy a little bit to give us a little bit of more understanding. But today we're going to take a look at three things. We're going to take a look at the fact that life starts in hearing the word. And then we'll take a look at that fact that life is given through the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk a little bit about that. And then that life is brought, is bought for you by Jesus Christ. He secured our salvation. He's the one who, when he tried to explain it to Nicodemus, you know, that you must be born again. And Nicodemus is saying, how can I enter my mother's womb a second time? And Jesus had to give him that explanation. And he said, you're a teacher. How can you not understand these things? And so we'll look at that, at these things. We're going to do it from the Old Testament. What I have come to know that in the Old Testament, it always points to Christ. Everything about the Old Testament lends itself to the direction of Jesus Christ and what God was wanting to do on the cross. What we're about to read together here in just a moment, how many of you, and I don't expect, just looking at my crowd, all of you, but just to get a feel for some of you who might know what's going through my head and the picture that I had put in my head, because when I read this, this is going to read like a screenplay for a movie. How many of you seen Pirates of the Caribbean? Okay, sure, there's a few of you. Or about some of the Indiana Jones movies, a few of you. Okay, not all of you. Well, in those movies, you know, they have either coming off or going on within them, you know, these bones and flesh and sinew, and you kind of see those, and you can, that's certainly what had come to the mental picture in my mind's eye as Hollywood had done those things. And I'm looking back at this, and I'm thinking, oh my goodness, they just borrowed some things from the scripture. Okay, but it reads like the Pirates of the Caribbean movie script or an Indiana Jones movie script. I want to ask you to take note how Ezekiel tells the account. It's almost like he's writing a movie. And you're going to see him say, and behold, as if to say, poof, you know, all of a sudden. And there it was. He even gives us sound effects, you know, which intensifies the drama. What movie is good without sound? You remember they used to have the silent movies and they were okay, but there's nothing like the sound effects. If you've ever seen Jaws, you know the sound effects. Dump, 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 dump. You know, who wants to get back in the water, right? And when I go swimming, I always think about those Jaws sound effects. Ezekiel gives us sound effects. When I read them, I can hear it in my ears, the sound of bones clattering. Let's read it together, okay? Tim, if you'll put it up on the screen for us, the Valley of Dry Bones, Ezekiel chapter 37, starting with verse 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, and sent me down in the middle, of the valley. It was full of bones. Not quite the worship service you would want to have, right? And he led me around among them, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, now catch this, I put this in red on purpose because we're going to come back to this. And he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. And then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinew upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So
I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a sound. And behold, poof, all of a sudden, there was rattling of the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, poof, all of a sudden, there was sinew on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. And then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. And so I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. And then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are indeed cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves. O my people, I will bring you into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people. And I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place in you, in your own land. And then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. Praise his name. Praise the Lord for his word to us. There's several things that I want to share with you. If you were to continue reading this particular chapter of Ezekiel, you would find out that he goes on to tell them that he will secure them from their sins, that he will buy them back. He goes on to tell them that he will take care of them, and he will cover for them, and he will do it himself. But as I read this, and as I listen to this, I want you to know several things. Number one, if I take you to Jesus, and I was to ask you what is his, when you read about him, what is his favorite title for himself? Could you answer it? Do you know what it is? Son of Man. Son of Man. I want you to know that this is actually pointing towards Christ, and oh, Son of Man, and we hear that, and then he's pointing to Christ, and that we need to understand that Jesus is all about it. And what this is really all about, and what it really lends itself to, is what's going to happen in the future when Christ goes to the cross. And I just need you to understand that I've highlighted those words because I want us to understand that Jesus Christ's own title for himself is Son of Man. It was his favorite title. Not Lord, not Son of God, but the fact that he was born of Mary, very man and very God. Praise his name. The other thing that I would share with you that as I was reading through this was two things that I would point out to you, that he mentions prophesying the word. And the second thing is he mentions about prophesying and to breathe the breath of God, the Spirit of God. Do you know what sets us apart as a church from any other religion? There's just a couple things. But one of them is the infilling of the Holy Spirit. There on the day of Pentecost, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm going to stop there. But the infilling of the Holy Spirit, we have what no other religion has. The other thing that sets us apart from other religions is that we have a risen Savior. He's come back from the dead. No other religion has that. Okay? It's what makes us unique. And it's what we put our trust in. And let me just make my three points and then I can let you go, okay? Life starts in hearing the word. There in verse 4, he said, Then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. That we need to be listening and hearing. It always starts with hearing the word of God, the word from the Lord. Our Bibles are important. Our Bibles have been preciously preserved. They keep finding more Dead Sea Scrolls, and it just keeps confirming and affirming the oldest book in history. And what I love about this book is that it passes in higher education, in the colleges. They have rules that make books acceptable and believable, and rules that do not. And this book in all of the secular educational higher educations passes every test, unbelievably so. Better than any other book of history in the world. God has made his word, precious to us and preserves it to us, but we need to hear it. And so he said to him, prophesy. Now, I don't know about you, but every time I heard about prophets, and I thought it was always an Old Testament thing, and prophecies, and we think of prophecies as telling the future kind of thing, but that's really, that is kind of the weakest definition there is of it. If you really want to understand prophecy and prophesying, you would understand that a prophet is basically a preacher. He just repeats what he or she has heard from God. We just tell them what God has said. And so he told Ezekiel, go and prophesy, go and proclaim. Prophecy means to proclaim. Go proclaim. Okay, just how it is. It starts with the word, go proclaim. Then he said to me, prophesy, proclaim over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. I just want you to know that the beginning of life for us is found in hearing the Lord. And how can they hear if no one sends them? You know, remember what Isaiah heard when he's in the temple, who will go for us? And he said, here am I, send me. Remember what Jesus said, I send you. I say, go there, therefore, and make disciples. Teach them to obey everything that I have commanded, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And lo, I am with you always. You see, proclaiming, prophesying, speak over these bones. And I just want you to know that life starts from hearing the word. And John writes, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God. And the same was in the beginning, and nothing that had been made was made without him. And in him was the life. The light of man. We're talking about Jesus. And we're talking about Jesus here because the word of God always points to the Son. And it points to God in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so in proclaiming the word, prophet is a preacher. It means to proclaim, to tell others what God has said and done. It means to be a witness. Before you think that it's for someone else, you need to know that you are a Bible scholar of the word as God tells you and shows you things. We were back in the Bible study, and different ones were talking about what God has said and what God was speaking and what God is revealing to them. When God reveals his word to you, what can you do but be glad in it? And it gives us life in real life. And so I say to you, testify to it, proclaim it. And that's what Ezekiel was told to do over these dead bones. And you might be thinking to yourself, well, yeah, but nobody's really listening. It's like nobody wants to hear about God. Everybody needs to hear about God. When Jesus came into our lives, you know what took place? Remember the story of the prodigal son? What the father said to the one brother who stayed with him and didn't spend his life in sinful living? And the son who did came back. He said, this brother of yours was dead, but now he's alive. You know what the work of the church is that we proclaim that we're going to go down to, it's the equivalent of going down to the graveyard, you know, where death is. And sharing life, the words of God to people who do not know God, to be brought from dead to life, to be filled with His Spirit. Which brings me, so Romans 10, 17 says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. I want to share with you, life is given through the Holy Spirit. This is where this is leading to. There's new life in the Spirit. In Genesis, Adam isn't alive until God breathed his breath into him. You know, he made him out of dirt, formed him, made him. He was probably a good-looking man. I have no doubt. God always does great things. He had a fine physique, and God formed him. But it wasn't until God breathed into his nostrils life, his ruach. The Hebrew word is ruach. And it's, by the way, it's the same word that hovered over the lands when he was in his creation of the earth. It hovered the wind. And when we're talking about Pentecost for the church, when God gives the church his Spirit, he comes in as a great wind, this breath of God. Breathe, oh breath of God, into him. And here in the valley of dry bones, it isn't until prophesied about breathing life into them. I pictured in my mind's eyes as I heard the bones rattling together and the sinew coming onto them in the flesh. And there they are lying all over these dead bodies. It looked like a valley of a morgue until God breathes the breath of life into them. With his Spirit, he breathes life into them. And that's what God is doing to you and I. It's what he did when we said, yes, Lord, here I am. Come, save me. Save me from my sins. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. We are born again. That's what Jesus was driving at. That we would have new life. That it would be a brand new life. And you say, well, Pastor Carl, I look like the same old person. Yes, you do. But there's a day coming when you're going to get a new body. God isn't done just yet. That when we get to heaven at the great resurrection, when he brings up our body, my wife has told me, she said, I'm certain he's going to make me look like I'm 30 again. Praise his name. And she looked fine when she was 30, I'm telling you. But God's going to give us a new body. He's going to give us a new name. He's going to give us new clothing. It's going to be like you can't imagine. No more pain, no more sorrow, no more aching. Trinity got up this morning, and we saw her. Was it this morning or yesterday? I don't remember now. And she was like, oh, and she's like stretching and in pain. And I'm saying, you're too young to feel that way. Wait till you're our age. And you got to get a hot shower before your hands start hurting. You guys know what I'm talking about. And arthritis kicks in. There's coming a day when we get a new body. Praise his name. And as I imagined all of them there lying around, it was like an army, Ezekiel said. And then God said, prophesy of them and call to the four winds that we would breathe the breath of God, the breath of life into them. And you and I we have in us as we live for God. But it's filled with the Holy Spirit, and that God, the Holy Spirit, is born in us, and born, we are born again by the Spirit in us. And it is also the Holy Spirit that sanctifies us. You know what sanctification is? Set up for holy purpose. Now, I was just earlier this morning we're talking about how I'm ornery everywhere I go. I'm ornery at work. I'm ornery here. But I want to tell you something. It's a sanctified ornery. It's got a holy purpose. I was in John Adams school one day, and there was a new teacher come along, and she found out I was a preacher, and she said, oh, we have a holy man amongst us. And I said, oh, wait, I got to tell you something. My sins were so bad that the only fix that could actually fix it was the blood of God's only son, the blood of God himself dying for me and shedding his blood and giving his life. It was the only cure. And I'm like everyone else in need of a cure. Nothing holy about it until God raises us up to his right hand and sets us there with Christ in that glorious place. So God gives us the word, and we need to proclaim the word. And then God gives us life through his Holy Spirit. Adam was there, and he didn't have life until, and he didn't have real life, the life that he was, until God breathed in him. And you and I are born again in the way that Jesus is talking about, because he has put his spirit in us. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? There in that valley, Ezekiel's beholding, and God's looking down, and they're breathing, and they're walking around like an army of God. And he says, this is the house of Israel. He says, you know what, Ezekiel? He says, you know what, my friend? These are my children. And I'm going to give them an inheritance. And I'm going to take care of them. These are mine. This is Jacob. And or Joseph and I'm or Jacob and I'm going to take care of them. And he goes on to say that these are his, and he's going to give them a land, and he's going to put them in Israel, and he's going to, you know, he's talking about, don't you, the very things that Jesus said. Which brings me to my last point. Life is bought for you by Jesus Christ. Jesus' favorite name for himself was Son of Man. Jesus Christ paid the price for our sins, for our iniquities, for our transgressions, and so that we could be made new. Oh, Nicodemus, he said, how can you not understand these things as one of Israel's teachers unless a man is born again? We make a lot of noise about that new birth, don't we? But that's what he's driving at. Walking in the Spirit, having life in Christ. And Jesus said, he said in his letter to John, John writes that Jesus said that because I live, you too will live. I want to read to you kind of in Jesus' contemporary, and I'll just read it. I don't have it up front. I'll just read it to you. What Jesus said, it's sort of the dry bones version of his authority, the authority of God. In John 5, the 19th verse, it says, so Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, the Son does likewise. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he himself is doing. A greater work than these will he show him, that you may marvel, kind of like the dry bones, you're marveling, and all of a sudden, poof. For as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he will. This is Scripture. For the Father judges no one, but has given all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father whom he sent. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my words and believes him who sent me has eternal life. Oh, the life we're looking for, the life that matters and the life that goes on forever. He who believes him who sent me has eternal life. He goes on to say, he does not come into judgment, that's you and I, but has passed from death to life. Truly, truly, I say to you, an hour has come and is now here when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear, again, here we go, back to the word, right? And those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and come out. And those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment. And Jesus is the one who said, because I live, you too shall live. I would say to the believer today, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. This is Hebrews 10:23. For he who promised is faithful. I want to come back
for a moment that vision that I had. If God can do it in a valley, God's gonna do it at the resurrection. And I don't know how it all works, and I'm sure that Ezekiel was like, man, it was like poof. He was like he was writing a movie. Poof. And behold, he uses the word behold. And behold, and all of a sudden. And that's how it's going to be for you and me. When we get our new bodies, when we are resurrected, and we're going to hear the trumpet sound, and the tombs will be opened up, and Jesus said they will go from dead to life. And what Jesus has done for us has taken us from dead to life. Sin entered through Adam. You know what happened. You know the story. Adam and Eve disobeyed God. And they didn't die right away. Satan tricked them, of course, and they lived a few hundred years before dying. They saw the sad effects of sin. Can you imagine watching your own children kill each other? Broken. I do believe, and I told you my friend at work, I bought him a Bible, and he and I were talking the other day, and he said to me, he said, Carl, I keep reading Genesis over and over and over again. He said to me, thank you for the study Bible. He said, thank you. He said, I don't get past it. He said, I actually can't get past this thought of Adam actually walking with God. He said, I marvel at that, the whole concept. Adam walking with God. And that was taken away from Adam and Eve and the Spirit of God. And one of the things that's different between us and the Old Testament is that the Spirit of God isn't with us, or wasn't with them. He came and he infilled them temporarily from time to time, and they were filled with the Spirit, and they would prophesy and do different things. But just like Ezekiel was filled with the Spirit in this occasion. But for you and me and for Adam, we have the Spirit of God always, forever, within us. And so the death that was promised for disobedience that came through Adam, Jesus fixed. Jesus fixed and brought life. And life, the real life that we're looking for, is only found in Jesus Christ. Let us hold to the believer, let us hold to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who is promised is faithful. To the non-believer, I can just tell you that God can give you the real life you're searching for. There is nothing sweeter than walking this life, knowing Jesus, making a difference in our world. And our world needs light. It's a dark world. In the workplace, I can tell you, I see things that just go rough all the time, and I watch teachers as they try to work through things and struggle. Their hands bound by rules. And I watch them as they try to bring their best. We are in a dark world, but there is nothing greater than knowing that you can step into that and make a difference. Be light. Be life. Speak life. Encourage life. God can give you the real life you're searching for. Father, I come this morning, and I just want to pronounce, I want to prophesy a blessing over the congregation. I'm asking you, O God, to fill them in a fresh new way each and every day, that you empower them to step into the world and proclaim life just the way Ezekiel did. I'm asking, Lord, that you will fill them up with your presence and your joy and your love and your light and your life. So much so that it oozes from them. I'm asking you, Lord, to help them to bear much fruit because they have your Spirit in them. And as we go out, Lord, that you will use us for your glory. And the people will know that they are alive, that they were dead, but now they're alive. And that we prophesy, proclaim, testify, whatever word that works for us, the goodness of God and the life that comes in knowing God. And the kind of life that only God you can give us, the life that we seek. And I pray that for them. And I pray for the person who's yet to come to you to understand that it's simply by coming to you and saying, Lord, I know that I'm broken. I know I have no relationship with you and I want one. And so I confess to you that I'm a sinner. And I ask you, O Jesus, to cover me with your blood and your sacrifice and make me your child. Take me, Lord, take me. From my dry, dead bones to life, to real life in you. Make me your child. Help me to be one of yours. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. May God cause his face to shine upon you. May his countenance be with you in such a real way this week that when you wake up in the morning, you find yourself saying, thank you, Lord. Another day to live for you. And then when you lay your head on the pillow, you can say, thank you, Lord. You've been with me through it all. Go in God's speed. God bless you.